सर एडविन जी सर, शैल वी स्टार्ट सर?
यस सर, वी कैन स्टार्ट। यस सर।
ओके, वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग दिस आवर स्पीकर ऑफ द सेशन डॉक्टर एडविन जियो एंड द पार्टिसिपेंट्स। आई वेलकम द स्पीकर एंड द पार्टिसिपेंट फॉर द फाइनल डे ऑफ द सटल स्पॉन्सर्ड एफडीपी ऑन अल्टरनेट फ्यूअल्स। I take immense pleasure to introduce our speaker of this session, Dr. Edwin Geo, Professor and Head, Department of Automobile Engineering, SRM University, Chennai. So, Professor Edwin Geo did his ME in the specialization of Thermal Power Engineering from Annamalai University and PhD in the area of IC engines related to the application of alternate fuel, namely rubber seed oil. From Anna University, Chennai. So, professor has also undergone postdoctoral at Ecole des University, France. He is also the visiting professor in Polytechnic University, France. Professor is an editorial member of a reputed journal, namely International Journal of Energy Research, research by Wiley Publications. Then, regarding the R&D work. Professor has completed AICTE Research Promotion Scheme project related to automobile and the IC engine application, alternate fuel for IC engine applications. Then professor is also having some international collaboration R&D works in France related to the use of industrial fish fat, municipal waste water, cooking waste cooking oil, etc. So, coming to the publications, more than 80 publication is having and have contributed 3 book chapters, and the research impact I-10 index is having more than 33 now. Okay, so with these few words, okay, I hand over the session to Professor Edwin Geo. Sir, please, sir.
Yeah. Good morning to you. Very good morning to another person here. So first of all, I would like to thank. The organizers for giving me the opportunity to share my knowledge. So thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Proceed, sir, please.
I will open my slide. Is this visible?
Yeah, it is getting presented, sir.
Okay. Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, full screen?
Now it is visible, sir. Full screen.
Okay. So my topic is alternate fuels availability and suitability. Now I am going to talk in two phases. This presentation is mainly the upcoming researchers and so those who want to do some research related to IC engines, alternate fuels, emission control in that aspect. So this presentation may help them to come up with some problem to take up some PhD program, or maybe some project proposal in that aspect. So I'm presenting. So two phases I am presenting. One is what are the different alternate fuels are available, and what are the the production methods are available to produce such alternate fuels. And the second phase I'll be talking about when you want to use this alternate fuels in IC engines, what are the modifications we have to make. So these two angle I'm going to talk. So the first phase of presentation, availability of alternate fuels, two piston engines, that we can say IC engines. So it's a common introduction. So first, what is the need to go for alternate fuels? That the crude oil availability is rapidly depleting in nature. There are two important things. One is we can say the crude oil availability depleting in nature, and second we can say the higher emissions from the transport sector. Either we can talk about an NOx emission or particulate emission, or we can say CO2 emissions. You know, now we are talking more about the global warming and CO2 emissions. So in what one of other way, the IC engines are contributing more about the emissions. Clear. So we don't bother about the crude oil availability, but the engine manufacturer, we can say the vehicle manufacturer, they bother more about the emissions which is coming from the engines or vehicles. So that is their prime you know aim. As everyone aware that, like, you know, we are going to implement, like, you know, the Bharat Stage 6. Already, you know, the vehicles already started coming up with the Bharat Stage 6. We have a new Bharat Stage 6 fuels available in the petrol pump, and especially in our Shell petrol pump, if you see, these are all Bharat Stage 6 fuels. There are a lot of initiatives taken from the government of India to reduce the emission, as well as from the manufacturer sites. You know, they are working very hard to meet the stringent emission norms. So what are the way, you know, we can able to control the emissions? You know, that is the main thing. We because as a customer, or we can say as a the customers of IC car, we normally think about, you know, the mileage, or we can say aesthetic look of the vehicle, in that aspect, right? How the drivability, the driving pleasure, you know, all those things, you know, only we used to think, but we never think about the environment. It is all, like, you know, the human nature. If we think about the, you know, the environment aspect, you know, we normally go for different options. But anyway, but in general, human beings are like that. You know, we always think about our own the comfort zone, right? Either we can say fuel economy or whatever it may be. But the engine manufacturer, they also don't want to go with the emission norms. But as the government is insisting, so they have to abide the rules of the government of India, we can say RI rules. With that, they have to come up with some vehicles which should, you know, the obey the norms of the government. So that's why, you know, there are a lot of new technologies coming up, and now they are going to implement Bharat Stage 6. So how long we can able to reduce this Bharat Stage 6 to 7 or 8, you know, how much, you know, see, emission will be there anyway from the engines. We cannot completely avoid the emissions. Emissions will be there, but we cannot make this emission to zero. That is not impossible. So that's why, you know, electric vehicle are coming up. People are talking about the electric vehicle or alternate power trains like fuel cell, you know, all those things are coming up. You know, these electric vehicles having two important things need to be addressed. One, we can say that, you know, the customers, you know, feedback. So if customer is liking the electric vehicle, then only the hit. So even though the government of India, we can say the auto manufacturers are putting a lot of effort to make efficient electric vehicle for all driving condition, especially Indian driving conditions are totally different than European, or we can say US driving conditions. So government is taking a lot of initiative to implement this electric vehicle. But again, there is a lot of conflict will be there. You know, people will be asking whether you are using renewable energy to charge the electric vehicle, or you are using again burning of coals and, you know, other non-renewable sources to convert electric power. From that, you are charging the vehicle. There is a lot of question. But this is an initiative from the government of India. As we can see, this may be the first step, right? In my perspective, if we are producing energy from renewable form and that energy is utilized to charge the electric vehicle, that is, we can say completely it is a non-polluting or non-emitting vehicle. Otherwise, you know, one or other way, somehow it is emitting. In the overall, seeing the life cycle analysis of the energy management, automatically some point of time it emitting emissions, like, you know, maybe it is not emitting on the roads, but it may be emitting in the industry or somewhere, like, you know, where we are producing the power. So there are a lot of conflict, but anyway, So here, if you have some questions later to that, I am ready to answer. But here, this topic is, what are the way we can able to reduce this emission, as well as we can say improve the emission, improve the performance using alternate fuels, right? So alternate fuel is also one of the best option to implement in IC engines, because the alternate fuels address two points. One, we can say the replacement of crude oil. Second, we can say reduce the emissions. So these are the and a lot of employability, you know. But this would have implemented in India, because as India is an agriculture based country, this would have implemented in about 10-15 years back, but nothing is materialized. Even now we are talking about the ethanol mixed petrol. Even like, you know, when I was studying college days, you know, some people came and talked about government is taking initiative to run the the engine with the methanol, or we can say ethanol mixed fuel. So these are all from the government side, that they should take a lot of initiative. But anyway, it's going on. So this aspect is mainly to use this alternate fuels and engines. So that is, we can say, first point, the crude oil availability rapidly reduces. The second, we can say that vehicle population increases at faster rate. The vehicle population, and especially in India, drastically it is increasing. Earlier, in about 20-30 years back, maybe we could see very limited number of vehicles on the roads. Or if you go to your village, you know, maybe you can see about 1 or 2, 3 vehicles, will be available. But here now you see that every house having minimum 1 or 2 vehicles now. I'm talking about the 4-wheelers. 2-wheelers, we have every individual is having 2-wheeler now. Every individual, not only one or two, every individual is having. If you have a 4-member family, 4 members are having a 2-wheeler, and 2-wheeler, and the 4-wheeler is concerned. Earlier we used to have only 4-wheelers. Now there is the new, because in Europe and all, US and all, they always have 2 4-wheelers in their family. So one is a small car which is used for the daily purpose, go to office, go to the grocery store, small purpose, they used to have a smaller vehicles, and they used to have a one bigger vehicle, SUV vehicle, mainly to go for a trip. They have one SUV at the weekends, or we can say during the vacation they go out and to stay somewhere else. For that, they have to. This culture is again coming to India now. So always they are having 2 kinds of vehicles. One is a smaller vehicle, and second, we can say SUV type vehicle. So the vehicle population is increasing at faster. And the second point is, the lifestyle of Indian people is increasing. It's good always. There is more employability, and people are getting job. So if you are ready to work, there is a possibility of job. So the income of the individual is increasing, the vehicle. So at all going to increase the vehicle population, right? Next is the use of diesel petrol keeps increasing day by day, right? So it is always proportional, right? When vehicle population is increased, automatically there is a possibility of diesel, the petrol, the consumption is getting increased. So not only the vehicle population, second, we can say that now you see that the roads are very, very good compared to olden days. Now, for example, if you take Tamil Nadu, the entire city is connected, the entire Tamil Nadu is connected with the different bypass. So now people are not ready to go in buses to travel, right? So people are taking their own car. Say earlier, the people never take their car to go out. For example, if they want to go to native, they won't take. Because see, one is the road condition is very bad. It will take long time to reach their hometown, right? But nowadays you see that all major cities are connected with bypass. So if the bypass is connected to the major city, they never think about taking their own car. So nowadays people are taking their own vehicle to go to migrate from one place to other place, right? So even, so earlier, if for example, if I'm living in Chennai, right? So if I want to attend one marriage in Trichy, so I will go by bus before the day, I go there and stay. then I have to attend, and then again evening I will come back, like that, you know. But here nowadays you think about, if I want to go to marriage in Trichy, I will take my car at 3 or 4 o'clock. I will reach at about 8 o'clock in the morning. I'll have breakfast, attend the marriage, taking the lunch there, and after that I can come back immediately. Same day I can come back. So these are all things are more comfort for the customer because of the best road infrastructure, which is especially in India. So these are all, like, you know, try to increase the consumption of diesel, right? Whether it's the second point we may talk about, whether this is really needed or not, that is the second point. But the actual case, the vehicle population is increasing, the consumption of diesel and petrol is keep increasing, right? So coming to the comparison of diesel and petrol, so the diesel consumption is always 6 times higher than the petrol, right? Because the petrol, only two wheelers and the four wheelers, that to domestic purpose, you know, we are using this four wheelers, but when you go for the other applications, like, you know, heavy vehicles movement, goods movement, or we can say the earth movers, are different applications of ICNG. So all are taking diesel consumptions, like, or we can say diesel locomotive. Now almost we are converting all diesel locomotives into electric powered trains. But anyway, so the diesel consumption is 6 times higher than the petrol. Import cost of petrol is increasing to very level, very high level, right? So see, as per this crude oil pricing policy, now the compared to earlier years, like, you know, the crude oil pricing is little bit decreasing, but India the price of petrol and diesel is keep increasing. That's what, like, you know, it is, but no one is ready to compromise their price, okay? But anyway, so the cost is increasing, so that is ultimate, whether the crude oil price is increasing or not, finally the cost of petroleum products are increasing day by day in India. This is a introduction about, and the global challenges and requirement. So what are the global challenges? You know, first you come for this global challenges. So what are the facts? Facts: increasing world population, right? You know, it is well known that the population is getting increased day by day, increasing energy demand, right? It's increasing energy demand. So when the population is increasing, so always there is an increase in energy demand. So limited energy supplies, environmental effects of energy use. When you use non-renewable, we can say non-conventional energy sources, automatically there is a possibility of, you know, more amount of environmental effects will be there. Either we can say emissions, or we can say disposal of waste when you convert the energy from one form to other form. These are the facts. But how can we overcome this problem? Right. So these are the consequences. Like, you know, what are the, you know, the way we can address these issues? Right. So one, we can say that develop new technologies. Right. So we have to develop new technologies to convert energy from one form to other form. Like, you know, for example, we are talking about the environmental effects. So we are using IC engines to convert heat energy into mechanical energy. Right, or we can say chemical energy into mechanical energy. But when you go for new technologies, like, you know, either fuel cell, for example. So fuel cell, you see that we are converting this fuel energy, or we can say chemical energy, into electrical energy directly. And when you are coming for this EV, electric vehicle, we are converting the electrical energy into mechanical energy. Right. So all things are possible when you develop new technologies. Automatically, we can able to address this. Second, we can say efficient use of energy. Right. So what are the ways we can efficiently use the energy, right? So for example, earlier we used this the yellow bulb, after that we used the tube light. Now we are using LEDs, right? Not only in a household application, but also in the automotive sector too. Nowadays we are using, if you take any vehicle nowadays, we are using LED lights in a automotive vehicles. So automatically when you use LED, automatically the energy consumption will be very, very less. It is about more than 50% drastically the energy consumption is reduced when you use the LED, or we can see any other energy efficient the applications, right? Next is use of all energy carriers, right? So energy carriers, you know, the plenty of energies are available in the nature, right? Either we can say solar energy or biomass or wind energy, any form you take, but conversion is very, very less, right? But now the government is taking a lot of initiative, and the people are also coming forward to use different kind of energy. Like, you know, earlier we completely rely on the government to depend on the electrical need, right? The electrical energy need. But nowadays, you know, people starting put their own solar panel on their house to use, like, you know, because when you put solar, there is no need to depend on the government, so you can produce your own energy, right? So actually India is the best country to implement, and especially South India is the best place to implement solar energy panel to get the electrical power, because, you know, we are getting completely to 12 hours of you know, the sun throughout the year, 365 days. Not anywhere in the world you will get, like, you know, maybe African continent and South India, we used to get, like, you know, the 12 hours of sun every day, almost every day, 365 days. So it is a very good option, but that awareness is missing. Actually, government is also a lot of taking initiative. Either we can say net metering, or so drastically, if you check the price of the solar panel about 5 years before and now, it is reduced more than 50%, right? So everyone should come forward to use the solar energy to produce their own energy need, right? So this is actually my principle. Like, you know, any energy application, see, we always depend on the government to supply the energy, but actually we have to produce our own energy. Either we can say biogas, or we can say solar energy, whatever may be. Biogas can be used for the cooking purpose, or biomass, efficient use of biomass to burn and to produce heat for the cooking purpose. These are all, like, you know, excellence of engineering applications. So we are not using. So these are, when you use biomass for the heating application, as well as we can say biogas for heating application and solar for electrical application. So if you use that aspect, like, automatically we can able to meet our own energy demand by ourselves, right? Next is the use of environmental protecting technology. Whenever we convert energy from one form to other form, there will be losses, right? This loss, either we can say emissions, or we can say the heat is liberated to the environment, or any other the byproduct which may affect the nature. So that is there, but we have to find the best method to reduce these kind of byproducts which is producing when you are converting one form of other energy, or we have to find certain technologies to use that the waste energy, or we can say waste byproducts. For example, in IC engines, there is more amount of emission is there, that you leave it. Emission we cannot do anything. So maybe you can capture CO2 emissions, or you can go for NOx trap, or any other particulate filters, something like that. You know, you can absorb or adsorb the emissions from the engines. But we have the exhaust heat. You see that how much amount of exhaust heat is wasted in the exhaust. It's about more than 40% of energy is wasted through the exhaust. So this energy can be tapped, and which can be utilized for some other applications. Now we have a turbocharger. Now we are recovering some amount of energy to recover, which can be used to operate the turbine in the turbocharger. Right, all are the same way. Maybe we can go for some cogeneration plant, like, you know, either Stirling engine, or we can say the organic Rankine cycle to refrigerate the, you know, the IC engine. So these are some of the areas, you know, you can work on. These are the options I am giving. You can work on. So this way we can able to recover the heat the recovered heat can be used for some applications. You know, the emissions, we cannot use it. CO2, CO, where can we use? We cannot use it. We can absorb using a filters or something like, you know, some chromium or platinum or some materials. We can absorb or absorb the emissions. But when the heat is liberated, that heat can be absorbed, and which can be used for some other applications. And the requirements of vehicle, right? So there are three aspects we have. One is, we can say, legislation side, customer side, and environment side. Legislation side, because, you know, ERAR, we can say any GARG, or we can say the NATRIP, or any other the assessing body, they look only for the consumption, safety, emission, noise. These are the basic parameters for the legislation point. When you want to produce your own vehicle, so the vehicle should follow the certain norms which is created by RI, or we can say GARG, or some agency, mainly on the fuel consumption, safety of the vehicle, emissions of the vehicle, and noise of the vehicle, right? So this is, we can say, legislation side, because these are the requirement of the production of the vehicle. So one, we have to see the legislation. Second, we can say customer side. So customer side, we mainly focus on the manufacturing cost, driving pleasure, operating cost, and sound. And also, we can say our mileage. That's the main criteria for any customer to buy a vehicle. So manufacturing cost, driving cost, and operating a sound. And environmental side, so recycling and resources, right? So now you see that when you in India especially, so we don't have any recycling policy in India. So now the government has implemented a recycling policy of the vehicle, right? Because already you may be aware that, you know, the recycling policy of the battery is the biggest challenge in a EV, right? So that's why, you know, the people are now creating a lot of new procedures to recycle the battery. Right, because the metals are, we can say, chemical present in the battery is more harmful for the, you see, when the EV is going on the roads, there won't be any emissions. But other point, like, you know, when you recycle, because every 5 years, you got to recycle the battery. When you recycle, there's a lot of emissions are coming. So anyway, so recycling policy is an important thing, because see, nowadays, more than 80% of the component, more than 90% of the component need to be recycled. So that is the new norms of any vehicle. For example, if you have vehicle, so if you want to recycle, the entire parts need to be recycled. Either it's a plastic component or a glass component, whatever it may be, whatever you use, it should be recycled. That kind of component you should produce. So these are the main criteria to produce a vehicle. One, we can say legislation, customer side, and we can say environment side. And the global challenges and requirements, right? So the x-axis have given a year, 1952 to 2050. See that the different parameters. So for example, you see that world mobility. So world mobility, the green graph, see the world mobility is going up, and after 2000 you see that it's going very steep. So the mobility, or we can say the traffic of the vehicle or movement of the vehicle, is drastically increasing. Clear? Drastically increasing. Or we can say the vehicle population is drastically increased after 2000. Until 2000, it is a somewhat narrowed graph, and after that it is, you know, it's going up after 2000. That you could see from the traffic. Right, before 2000, there were not much traffic, but after 2000, that traffic is too much, and the vehicle population is increasing too much, right? And see that the blue color, it's a world population. So the already, you know, have told in the first slide, and the population also increasing, and mobility is also increasing. Population, you know, it's directly proportional. When population increasing, obviously mobility will be there. And when you come for this red color graph, this is the world CO2 emissions. The CO2 emission is the biggest threat now. Because see, any Paris this one policy, or any policy you take, now government is, or we can say the world is focusing mainly on the CO2 emissions. Because see, the iceberg are melting. And the global temperature is increasing day by day. So we have to go for CO2 emissions. We have to cut down the CO2 emissions, because that's, you know, you can see a lot of ads are nowadays coming down, coming up, coming in the TV. There is an ad like, you know, you have to reduce the use of vehicle. At least you should cut down one day use of the vehicles, right? So these are all maybe completely reduce the CO2 emissions. Like, you know, the CO2 emission is increasing drastically. And the crude oil availability. So the blue color line shows the crude oil availability. The crude oil availability is reducing day by day. And this graph shows the sales of the automobiles in India from financial year 2011 to 2019. You see that the blue color shows the two wheelers, and the dark blue shows the passenger vehicle, and gray shows the commercial vehicles, and the brown color shows the three wheelers. See, any segment you see that, any other two wheelers or passenger vehicle, commercial vehicle, and three wheelers. Until 2019, all the vehicle population, or we can say sales, are increasing. Maybe in 2020, it is reduced little bit, that everyone aware that because of COVID situation, the automotive sales coming down, but nowadays it is boosting, right? So the Kia Motors sales is increased about 33%. Maruti, the sales is increased about 12%, and almost overall we can say about 20% increasing about from September 2022 till date. The sales of four wheelers is like, you know, or even like two wheelers in increasing day by day, because nowadays no one is ready to go in a public transport, so everyone want to use individual their own vehicle, like either two wheelers or four wheelers, because of the virus, right? So anyway, any situation you take, like, you know, the graph is increasing, the vehicle population, either we can say two wheelers, passenger vehicle, whatever it may be, so all are increasing in nature. And the Indian vehicle market. So coming to the contribution of Indian vehicle market, you see 51.22%. So 51.22% the market shared by owned by Maruti Suzuki, right? Suzuki is a major contributor of Indian market. So more than 50% of market share was owned by Maruti Suzuki. And second, we can say Hyundai Motors, it is about 16%. And 7% Mahindra, and about 6% Tata Motors. 5.4% Honda cars, 4.46% by Toyota Kirloskar, and 2.75% Ford Motors, and remaining Renault, Nissan, Volkswagen, and other. So you see that more than 50% market share is owned by Suzuki. And so this graph shows, like, you know, the oil reserves, right? All the oil reserves and the production consumption of different countries. First, for example, US, right? So coming to the world usage, right? Or we can say world reserve, 2% of reserve is available in US, right? 2% of oil reserve is available in US. But you see that OPC, Organization of Petroleum Exporting Companies, right? Mainly Kuwait, Saudi Arabia, Iran, Iraq, right? So these countries, like, or we can say Middle East countries, the oil resource is about 70%. The world total oil reserve, from the total oil reserve, 70% is owned by Middle East, or we can say Organization of Petroleum Exporting Nations, mainly these regions, like, you know, the Middle East region. So 70%, and rest of the world 20%, including India, right? So US is 2%, and Middle East is about 70%, and the rest of the world 20%. Coming to the production, so reserve is there, right? Coming to the production, 8% by US, 41% by oil exporting companies, 50% rest of the world. But coming for the consumption, you see that 24%, it is the highest, 24% by US, right? And 9% by Middle East, and about 60% by other countries, like rest of the world, right? So this is the oil share of the crude oil reserves in 2018, right? See that oil exporting companies about this much billion barrels, about 79.4% of the oil is exported from this oil exporting company, and other countries about 308 billion barrels. It's about 20%, right? So the contribution of this, right, this in the sense contribution of main oil this countries. So we have Venezuela at the higher region, right? And you see that graph, like, so you can understand what are the different countries are: Algeria, Angola, Congo, Ecuador, Gabon, Iran, Iraq, Kuwait, Libya, Nigeria, Saudi Arabia, UAE, right? These are the main countries. Here you have given a percentage of how much the different nations are giving the oil. And this is total energy consumption. I'm not talking about the crude oil, but the total energy consumption, you see that either we can say transport or industrial application or any other application. So the 41% of energy is coming from coal. 41% of energy is coming. That's what I told you, like, you know, the problem with the EV vehicle in India, right? So if you are using the electricity which is coming from the renewable form, then only you can say it is a zero emitting vehicle, or we can say non-polluting vehicle, EV. But here in India is concerned, about more than 41% of energy is coming from coal. And with that energy, you are recharging the battery. It is not completely, non-polluting this one vehicle. But, you know, maybe it may pollute while it runs. Maybe in the city or on the roads, it will not pollute. But other side, it is polluting. So India is, Norway, you see that, for example, Norway, Germany.
Can we ask one question for you?
Yes.
Yeah. Professor, as per the Indian norms, nowadays we are changing it to BS4 to BS6, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So in the BS6 engine, they have to modify the engine, but they are not yet changed the fuel related to BS6 engine. The fuel sulfur content must be five times lesser than the BS4.
Yes.
Say an example, 50 ppm sulfur content in the BS4 engine. Now we have to reduce 10 ppm for when you use BS6 engine, right?
Yes.
But the engine has to be modified, but still now the government has not given the BS6 fuel.
Yes.
If you use BS4 and BS6 for the corresponding petrol of BS6 engine, when you use BS6 fuel, what would be the emission output?
No, actually, always when you use BS4 fuel in BS6 vehicle, automatically the emits higher, like compared to this norms.
Yeah, still you will get a pollution, right?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. But the government has not taken
BS6
fuel.
Yes. That's what I can offer. Engine manufacturers ready to launch their vehicle. Already they have launched. Almost the new vehicles are all BS6 vehicles only, but the government is not taking that initiative. So that the shell pump they are using, but
and also government has to insisted that 70% of nitrogen oxide has to be reduced in BS6 engine. But they are not given the proper fuel. So the mistake is from the government.
Yes. Yeah. You are true. Absolutely right. Even like in EV also, see, all auto manufacturers are ready to produce the EV, but the EV policy is not there. Either we can say recharge policy, or we can say battery recycling policy, or we can say battery swapping technology. Something should be there. Then only the manufacturer. There are a lot of issues from the government side that we cannot talk. Technology side.
Yeah, like you are engineers, you can insist to the government to give a clean fuel.
Because
you are doing a lot of effort for making the changes in engine. Apart from that, if you provide a very clean fuel to the engine, you will get no pollution outlet from the exhaust.
Yes. I came to know that from the petrol, the pump, they said, like, you know, for to store this bar stage fuel, they have to coat one more layer on their storage tank.
Okay.
So that much, the care should be there. So, but you know, as you said, like, you know, government is not coming forward, but anyway, it will happen. It will happen.
But also
Yeah.
lead, lead is a small percentage, lead is also present in the fuel.
Yes,
That
yes,
will
yes.
also have to eliminate.
Yeah,
Thank you, bros. Thank you.
yeah, yeah. Okay, thank you,
Bye.
thank you, thank you for your suggestion. Yeah.
Sir, Edwin sir, Ankit here. Hi, sir.
Ankit, yeah, tell me again.
Sir, for your kind information, BS6, can you hear me, sir, properly?
Yeah, I can hear you. Yeah.
Sir, all over India, BS6 is available.
Fuel.
Yes, sir.
No, actually, I'm not very sure about
No. Yes, sir,
here.
it is.
It is not available. Only in
No.
Shell petrol pump it is available.
No, sir, no, sir. It is not like that, sir. Sir, even before BS6 norms were implemented, IOCL and BPCL and HPCL, they all started producing BS6 fuel. And when we were in talks, when I was working in D when I was in DTU, people had come there. So we had our professor had purchased a sulfur measuring equipment. Only it can measure only sulfur in fuels. So we tested 2 years back. When we tested, all the fuel had ppm less than 10. Sulfur ppm less. The sulfur content was less than 10 ppm in all the fuels 2 years back.
Browser,
Less than
which
10
company,
ppm.
browser? Browser, which company? Which company petrol? Is it Indian Oil Corporation or
It is all of them.
all?
HPCL, yes.
But
Okay.
Ankit, Ankit, you are right. Actually, in Tamil Nadu, we are not very sure because already I have personally I encountered some petrol pump. My friend is also having petrol pump. He's at
Okay.
in IOCL or BP. Maybe some of the BP outlets are having new BP outlets are having, not all. But the Shell, they are in all outlets they are giving Bharat Stage 6 Shell.
Okay, sir. Okay, but here it is everywhere. Even because when we talk to people in Mathura refinery also, and in the refinery here in there is one refinery in MP also, that is
Okay.
BPCL refinery. So they all said that they are already making BS6 fuels
Yeah.
everywhere.
But in Tamil Nadu, I am not very sure. Maybe new outlets are having, but not all. Shell is
Here
Shell
it
is.
is not there, sir. Here it is not there.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
So coming to the potential alternate fuels, there are two options are there for IC engines. One is liquid fuels and gaseous fuels. Liquid fuels mainly alcohols and vegetable oils. Options like, you know, so we have plenty of options, but so viable options are alcohols and vegetable oils. So from that alcohols we can derive diethyl ether and dimethyl ether. So these are the two derivatives from alcohols which can be used in either CA engine or SA engine, right? So these are the liquid fuel options available. And gaseous fuel, hydrogen producer gas, biogas and landfill gas. So these are the some of the options, right? So coming to the production, so this is a very basic. I will go through this. Ethanol, so which can be produced from the corn, sugarcane, sugar beet, and fermentation process. Methanol can be produced from coal, organic waste, natural gas by synthetic technology. DDME, so it's a derivative of again alcohol, or which can be produced from the coal and natural gas by the synthetic technology. And vegetable oil, so as everyone knows that it can be extracted from the seeds of vegetable oil through transesterification, or we can say cracking or enzyme methodology. So we can produce vegetable oil. And so this is a concept of conventional and alternate fuel. See that, like, you know, the structures, right? So when you burn liquid fuels, like how about the emissions when you burn? See, that's why, you know, in Delhi almost all the vehicles are converted into gaseous fuels, like, you know, either we can say LNG or CNG, right? But when you burn any gaseous fuel, automatically the emissions is very, very less. That everyone knows. This is mainly because of number of carbons. You see that the methane, you see the number of carbon, see that only one carbon and four hydrogen, CH4, right? And you take the hydrogen, H2, there is no carbon is present. It is a completely carbon-free fuel. So when you are burning any gaseous fuel, the carbon is very, very less. When the carbon is less, automatically carbon based emission will be less. But when you go for you see that, like, you know, molecular structure of any other petroleum based, for example, isooctane, you see the number of carbons, isooctane. And this is, we can say, the cetane structure. See that, or we can say, the, for example, here you see the diesel fuel structure, right? Here you see the vegetable oil structure. This is a vegetable oil, not biodiesel, vegetable oil. So any structure you see that in a liquid form, automatically number of carbon is more. So when the number of carbon atoms are more, automatically this will emit more amount of emissions, right? all the carbon-based emissions. So, but when you're coming for this ethanol-based fuel, for example, ethanol, methanol, you see that how many carbon, C2H5OH and CH4OH. So the number of carbon is reduced. So that's why I said, like, you know, the options for the liquid fuel mainly rely on alcohol fuels because of emissions. And I'm emission point of view, I'm talking about. See that ethanol and methanol having very less number of carbon atoms present in the fuel. So automatically, see, when you see the structure and the property itself, you can able to predict the emissions. There is no need to run the engine, right? So from the structure and the property itself, we can able to, that's what I want to insist again. See, when you want to select any research problem, you should see the properties. So from the properties only, you have to decide what way you have to move forward to reduce the emission and improve the performance, right? So these are the options, and you know, propane, butane. So these are some of the examples I have given. So from that, you can able to understand some you know, the view about the for example, if you want to say the example, so for example, if you burn carbon fuel, right, how about the carbon emissions? It is more, right? More amount of carbon will be there. But when you burn you know, world and days we use kerosene stove, right? How about the emissions in the kerosene stove? Now we are using LPG, right? How about the emissions in the, or we can say carbon deposit in the our gas stove, right? So you can see the difference from the household itself. We can able to see the difference how much the carbon is emitting from solid fuel to liquid fuel and a gaseous fuel. So it is all based on number of carbon atoms present in the fuel, right? So this is the production method. I'm also a little bit going fast. So this is some of the ethanol production method, methanol production, biodiesel production. See, this you would have studied, right? The sugarcane fermentation, distillation, drying, with that you can able to produce ethanol. And by means of a gasification of syngas, you can able to produce methanol. And by means of transesterification, by adding alcohols with the help of some catalyst, you can able to separate the glycerol and methyl ester, through which we can able to produce the biodiesel. So these are the some of the production methods. And coming to the gaseous fuels, you know, the biogas, which can be produced from the organic waste, cow dung, leaves, and anaerobic digestion, a process of absence of air. A producer gas, which can be produced from the wood, coal, gasified, it is a partial combustion. So here, the biogas is produced absence of air, or we can say absence of oxygen, and the producer gas is formed by means of the partial combustion of any substances, right? Or we can say wood or charcoal or whatever. So this is the difference. You know, biogas produced without presence of oxygen, and producer gas produced based on the partial combustion, right? And the main fuel is hydrogen, right? So hydrogen, we are talking about the future fuel, right? Always we use that term, future fuel. But there are a lot of drawbacks are there by the production method, or we can say safety wise and application wise. It is, the people are saying it's not safe, you fail to use, but technologies are available, as some of the participants said that. So the, if you have a proper policy, or we can say implementation from the government side, this is possible, hydrogen as fuel for engines, right? So these are the some of the methods to produce hydrogen from coal and natural gas by means of the steam reforming process, and from water. So this is one of the advantage, you know, why we are telling hydrogen is a fuel feasible, because it can be produced from the water, because water is having H2O. So when you split H2O, you can able to produce H2 and O2. That is the biggest advantage of you know, the hydrogen fuel. Again, when you burn this hydrogen along with the oxygen, H2 plus O2, it gives an H2O. That is a magic of this fuel, right? But the problem is with having a production, right? So these are the some of the methods we can produce hydrogen: electrolysis, thermal decomposition, thermochemical reaction, photobiolysis, and also from the food and other waste, which can be produced by the anaerobic digestion process. You know, the anaerobic digestion, normally the reaction is peak at 45 to 50 degrees centigrade, or we can see even the react 30 to 50 degrees centigrade, it gives the best efficiency, or we can say maximum percentage of methane will be present. But if you elevate the temperature, it's about 60 to 80 degrees centigrade, we can able to produce hydrogen. It is called biohydrogen. So this also one of the option, right? Though we are not producing much amount of hydrogen by means of anaerobic digestion, but there is a lot of focus going on, like, you know, the production of biohydrogen from the waste. So this is the schematic, shows the hydrogen production by means of, you know, comparing two power plants, because already showed that when you want to split this hydrogen and oxygen from the H2O, we need higher energy. So these are the some of the other methods, you know, through which we can crack hydrogen, like, you know, natural gas reforming and electrolysis, right? Even like, you know, when you combine nuclear power plant with the hydrogen production, so with the cogeneration plant, we can able to crack hydrogen. So this is a biogas. So it's very most familiar thing. So the cow dung maybe, or cow dung or any food waste may be fed into the bioreactor where digestion takes place, so that it produces the biogas, which is about 60 to 80% of methane and other CO2 gases. If you want to split this methane from the biogas, it gives a better efficiency. But a normal plant, it is very difficult to, you know, the clean, or we can say split this methane from other gases. The cost is expensive. But when you go for a bigger plants, so we can able to split methane from other gases. So this is one of the option which can be produced from the newer form. So alcohols, so advantages, it is a renewable nature, high octane fuel, less emissions, more molecules of exhaust, higher pressure, more power, higher latent heat of heat, cooler intake, higher volumetric efficiency, lower sulfur content in the fuel. So these are the advantages. Disadvantage, low calorific value, half of the petrol, more aldehyde emissions in the exhaust, more corrosive in nature on metals, rubber, plastics, poor cold weather starting, low vapor pressure and evaporation, poor ignition characteristics, high self energy, invisible flame, safety risk, vapor lock in the flame fuel line. So actually, just you go through, if I go in depth, it will take more time. Again, I have only half an hour more. So these are the some of the advantages as well as disadvantages of alcohol fuels. And about biodiesel, it is again renewable, environment friendly, no sulfur and aromatic compounds present, because, you know, you see that crude oil, it is more of pH compounds, polyaromatic hydrocarbons are present. It is basically hydrocarbon fuel, but here it is all ester based fuel. So even like, you know, for example, if you crack the vegetable oil by using a thermal cracking process, automatically you will get hydrocarbons. But when you do transesterification process, we are converting esters, right? So we can get the esters base. So the one of the other advantages of the renewable base fuel, either we can say alcohol or we can say biodiesel, both are having oxygen content in the fuel itself. You know, that lead to better combustion. Next is a higher flash point. So it's safety wise is best, like, you know, we have to see all aspects of the fuel, whether it's a storage or we can say usage or we can say emissions. In all aspects, when you look at it, is having higher flash point, so we can say safe to use, higher freezing temperature, better lubricity, right? And disadvantages, comparatively lower heating oil compared to diesel, right? Because all parameters are compared with diesel, higher viscosity, poor corrosive property, and heavier than diesel. So poor long-term acceleration stability, right? So here the problem with the biodiesel is when you open this biodiesel, it always react with the oxygen, and we have instable oxidation. So there is a problem, one of the problem with the biodiesel. So when you produce biodiesel, automatically we have to use it as early as possible. When you store it for a long time, or when it stored in a sunny region, or we can say wherever, like, you know, the axon is present, there is a possibility of oxidation. And about the hydrogen, so it's a carbon free fuel. It is the best the fuel, or as per the technical point of view I am talking about, is a carbon, there is no carbon is present in the fuel, so there won't be any emissions, right? So renewable, it can be produced from water, higher break thermal efficiency because of calorific value. The calorific value of hydrogen is about 120 megajoules per kilogram, higher self-finished temperature, high resistive to knock, higher compression ratio. Using hydrogen, other low quality fuel performance can be improved. So disadvantages: high cost of production of production and storage, not a safe fuel, low ignition energy, very high flame velocity. So there are two main important points for the hydrogen, for the disadvantage. So low ignition energy, so you see, it needs very less amount of energy to ignite, right? That is the biggest disadvantage of hydrogen. And second, we can say it has a very high flame velocity. It's about more than 200 meter per centimeter per second. So automatically, when the flame started, it moves very fast, right? And it is it's a kind of a colorless flame. So it is highly dangerous when there is any possibility of explosion or leakage of hydrogen. So it develops less power, very low density, because the density of hydrogen is very, very low. So automatically, when you see that aspect, automatically it produces less power. So because it replaces more amount of oxygen, high NOx emissions, high combustion temperature. And about the producer gas, so already told you, like, the producer gas which can be produced from the partial combustion of wood or any biomass waste, which is about combination of methane and hydrogen, right? And more amount of CO and other gases, right? So as the producer gas cannot be used as a IC engine fuel, but maybe we can use this fuel for stationary applications. Like, you know, we have the Cummins and other engine manufacturers, they are producing the stationary engine for producer gas application, or we can say biogas application. Specific application engines are available in the market, so which can be used for maybe in a hill area, for example, where it is very difficult to transmit the electrical energy from the one place to other place. In that places, you know, this producer gas can be used for production of electricity, or we can say as a generator. So biomass based renewable, less emissions, burning CO and hydrogen. So it can be produced from the rural level. So byproducts, high quality of tar and oil, right? So because when you produce biogas by gasification process, automatically, so you'll get the three different products, you know, liquid, gas, and solid. Solid is your tar, and liquid is, you will get bio oil, or we can say pyrolytic oil, right? So disadvantages, so it's very low calorific value compared to diesel or gasoline, very, very low. So low engine power output is higher emissions, because the composition itself, it has more amount of CO2 and CO. So automatically it emits, because it will not participate in the combustion process, it emits. Also, again, as the calorific value is low, the combustion temperature, combustion efficiency is not better, it will have a lot of emissions. But in the specific application, as I said before, like, you know, when you go for a rural area, or we can say hill area, where power is not there, in that places we can use for this kind of gas. Like, you know, second, the biogas is again bio-based renewable, less emissions, suitable for rural application for electricity, byproduct, it's a good maneuver. Like, you know, biogas is a good option actually. When you go for a large scale production process, right? So small scale, we cannot use it for the IC engine application, but we can use it for, like, you know, either cooking purpose, because, you know, carrying off this biogas is the biggest difficult, like, you know, when you go for a small scale plant, bigger scale plant, you know, you can compress the biogas and you can use it in the engine. But again, as I said before, 60 to 80% of methane is there, remaining all other gases that will unnecessarily, you know, occupy the space. So we have to split this gas, or we can say we have to clean up the gases. So when you clean up, automatically it needs, like, you know, again, more money involved. And if it is going for a large scale plant, so that is also possible, so that we can use the compressed natural gas. So The disadvantages: lower engine performance, lower output, not suitable for mobile application storage. If we cannot just like that say it is not suitable for mobile application, but when you are able to produce in a large scale, it is possible. So these are all, like, you know, the first phase of my presentation: availability, then going for the suitability of all these alternate fuels in engines, right? So when you come for these kind of, you know, whatever we discuss, alcohol fuel, or we can say biodiesel, or any other gaseous fuels like hydrogen, biogas, or whatever it may be. So when you want to use these fuels for engine application, you know, some fuels need some modification, some fuels there is no need of any modifications. So what are the way, you know, the we have to modify? So the modification is based on two types. One, we can say nature of the fuel, and second, we can say property of the fuel, right? So the nature of the fuel, see, for example, gaseous fuel, right? So for example, the density of the fuel cannot be changed, right? So it is the basic nature of the fuel. So when you have a gaseous fuel, you have to go for some modification, like, you know, for example, you have to go for a bigger fuel tank, or we can say kind of cylinders, compressed cylinders, or we need to have some safety devices to feed this fuel from fuel tank to engine, or we need to have a special carburetor, or we can say fuel injection system for gaseous fuels, right? These are all based on the nature of the fuel. The second, we can say property of the fuel. So certain property we can modify while we produce the fuel, right? During the transesterification process, or we can say fermentation process, or any or anaerobic digestion process, during the process we can able to optimize the property of the fuel. But beyond that, we cannot modify the property. See, after that, like, you know, we have to modify the engine. Actually, best fuel, see, modification on the engine is norm-based problem. You know what we talked about in the past discussion, right? Either modification, for example, see, we are talking about the bar stage 6. So bar stage 6 needs some additions, right, in the engine. But these additions cannot be implemented in other vehicles, right? So 2020, or again 2020 models will have a bar stage 6. How about 2000 model vehicle? How about 2005 model vehicle? How about 2010 vehicle? Even like 1980s vehicles are running on the roads. How about the emissions level of that vehicles? See, in India, people will not buy or change their vehicle 5 years once or 10 years once. Like, people, once they think that is once their life achievement. Once they buy a vehicle, they will run the vehicle for long duration. Like, you know, lifelong they run. So even after 15 years, they renew the vehicle and they run. See, how about the emissions of that particular vehicle? So that is a problem. For example, if you able to produce certain quantity of fuel which can be adapted for that engine too, like, for example, we talked about bar stage 6 fuel. If you supply this bar stage 6 fuel in the for example, 2000 model vehicle, it can able to reduce certain level of emissions, right? So we cannot implement, or we cannot insist the vehicle owner to implement the new technologies in their old vehicle. That is not possible. But if you supply this bar stage fuel in the old vehicle, or, you know, some way or other way, we can able to reduce a little bit of emissions. So fuel plays a major role. So if you supply a very good fuel in the petrol station, automatically most of the problems solved. So this will happen only by means of the nature of the fuel and the production of the fuel. If you're able to produce very good fuel during the production itself, or if you're able to produce a good property fuel while we produce the fuel, automatically problem solved, right? So any engine manufacturer, or we can say any researcher, if you go, the fuel should be clean. So if you give a clean fuel, automatically we won't have any problem with combustion. And even, like, you know, you can modify some amount of the modification on the combustion chamber part, or we can say fuel feeding system, so that we can able to reduce the emissions and improve the emissions. See, whenever you adopt a new technology to reduce the emissions, automatically that will reduce the emissions. At the same time, that will improve the efficiency also, right? But if you are not able to reduce the emissions during the combustion process, it is coming out from the exhaust. And the exhaust, we have after treatment process. With that after treatment process, there is no use. Only it absorbs or absorb the emissions, that's it. There's no other purpose, right? It is a kind of a junk box which is there at the tail end, right? So there is no, even like, you know, it may create some problem at the engine, like back pressure will be developed so that the engine efficiency may drop. So actually this chemical factory at the outlet of the engine is not needed. So if you come up with a new technology to completely eliminate this after treatment system, that is the best the engine manufacturer can say, best design, I would say, right? But it is not possible. Like, you know, sometimes, you know, I said like before this first slide, the nature of the field property of the way, something we cannot modify, we cannot change. In that aspect, we have to go for, in that aspect only we have to go for this addition at the exhaust, right? So that we are going to see this part. So next is the qualities of SA engine fuel. You know, when you want to use a fuel in an SA engine, so certain qualities need to be maintained. One, we can say volatility. So you should have good volatile fuel, because any fuel, like, you know, either it's SA engine fuel, C engine fuel, it should be good volatile in nature. Because see, fuel will be atomized in the inlet manifold, or we can say in the combustion chamber. So it should immediately convert to liquid to vapor form, and it should mix with fuel, right? So that is the main thing. When you able to convert this liquid form into vapor form, mixes with the fuel, or we can make it homogeneous, then the emission will be reduced drastically, right? So the always the problem with the engine is, like, you know, the NOx and CO emissions. Like, you know, when you try some technologies, or we can say new technique to increase the NOx emission, the smoke emission will reduce. And when you able to you know, the reduce the NOx emission, smoke emission will increase. Always there is a, you know, the trade off is the biggest challenge in engine. But when you go for, you know, the homogeneous combustion, right? Homogeneous function, so simultaneously we can able to reduce NOx and smoke emission. But that's why, you know, we have a new technology, HCCA, homogeneous charge combustion, in, say, you know, then in our diesel fuel. So these are all happening because of this property mainly. So if it volatile after injecting the fuel, because, you know, before it inject volatile, there will be a problem with the injection system. After injecting, if it is immediately volatile in nature, so it can mixes very good with the air and make a homogeneous mixture. So completely combustion will be very smooth, gradual combustion. So NOx will not be very high. At the same time, the smoke will be reduced because there is no liquid particle, because the fuel burns in a liquid form, there's a more possibility of, you know, carbon particles. The carbon particles can be completely eliminated when you burn. That's why, you know, the smoke emissions are very, very less in SA engine, because it is homogeneous charge. But in C engine is heterogeneous, more amount of the liquid droplets will be there. There's a possibility of more carbon-based emission. And the second, we can say starting and warm-up, right? So any vehicle, it should start immediately, either in the morning or any time if you start, it should start at a single kick, or we can say a single push-off button. So always that should be there. So that is the one of the major criteria of selecting a fuel, the starting and warm-up. And operating range performance, right? So any range of performance, like, you know, engine is operating on lean mode or rich mode or over rich, over lean. See, any mode, or we can say coming to the engine condition, either it's a terrain mode or mud region. So any engine operation, so the fuel should be very, very good, or it should have good performance in all aspects. So crankcase dilution, it is one of the, again, the problem with the engine. So it should not create more crankcase dilution. So vapor lock characteristics, as I said before, like volatility, and it has some connections. So it is more volatility, there's a possibility of vapor lock. Because when you inject the fuel, before injection, because the pressure is built up in the fuel pump automatically, so there's a possibility of vapor lock will be created. That's what I mean, that, like, you know, when the fuel is volatile, immediately after the injecting the fuel, then we can able to create more amount of homogeneous charge combustion. So vapor lock characteristics should not be there, and anti-knock characteristics. So that is one of the important characteristics, mainly in SA engine. So SA engine, biggest problem is knocking, or you can say detonation. So it should not knock. So for example, if the fuel is having a higher octane number, automatically it will have a higher anti-knock characteristic. So that's why, you know, we have a, you know, in petrol station, you can find two kinds of petrols, ordinary petrol and high octane, or we can say high speed. You know, so it's based on the the company, the brand name changes, right? So we have two varieties of petrol is available, or we can say diesel is available in stations. Either it's a high octane, low octane, or we can say high cetane, low cetane. So all leads to this, especially this noctane, high octane fuel leads to anti-noctality. So then next is cum deposit, because see, cum deposit is the biggest problem. So because when the engine is running for a longer period, longer time, longer duration, so automatically there's a possibility of, you know, the cum deposit maybe there inside the combustion chamber or the fuel injector, because now we have a GDI engine. So the for example, if it is a manifold injection, we don't have a problem with the carbon deposit over injector, because now we are injecting the inlet manifold. But now the new technology came, GDI engine, so the fuel is injected directly inside the combustion chamber. So if the fuel is having a gum deposit problem, automatically that will choke the fuel injector. Over a period, the fuel injection will not happen. So that also we have to see. The sulfur contents, again, you know, we talked about during this discussion, so should be a zero sulfur content. But you know, people are working, like, you know, this again production, like, you know, when you be able to produce good fuel, these are all, like, you know, something we can control during the production itself, right? So if you have a best optimized production method to produce good quality fuel, then we don't have any problem with the modification. There is no need of modification, actually. Any engine, it can be adapted, right? And the qualities of C engine, again, so knocking characteristics, quality, this is the same almost, volatility, starting characteristics, smoking and odor, viscosity. See, again, viscosity is the one of the biggest challenge in C engine. So if the fuel is having less viscous, already I have mentioned that if you inject the fuel, the atomization will be very good, and the droplet size diameter is reduces it, easily convert to liquid into vapor form, mixes with fuel. So, but in SA engine, CA engine fuel, we don't have options, actually. We have only one option is there, biodiesel. But the biodiesel, when you produce the biodiesel using a transesterification method, automatically it having more than 3 CST of viscosity, any fuel if you take, right? Even like sometimes it's about 4, 5, 6. But if you find some alternate methodology to find this or to produce the fuel, or we can say biodiesel from vegetable oil, other than transesterification, and it produces the viscosity is equal to the diesel viscosity, we don't have a problem, right? Next is the corrosion and wear, and the handling is. So these are the important qualities we have to maintain while producing the C engine fuel. So actually, whatever we talked about is all conventional production method. See, if you try something out of box, and if you come up with some new technologies to produce a fuel, then the problem solved. So next is usage, right? So any fuel which can be used in CA engine, or either say SA engine fuel or CA engine fuel, it can be used in both the engines, right? So what is the need to go for these options? Like, now, actually, the availability for C engine fuel is very, very limited. Already I told you, we have only one option, biodiesel. There is no other options. But SA engine fuel, we have plenty of options are there. All alcohol fuels, all gaseous fuels are used for the SA engine. But already I have mentioned the first slide, the consumption of diesel is 6 times higher than that of the petroleum. So options are very less for C engine, but usage is higher. So what we have now, either we have to find out new fuel which can be used for a CA engine. But already told you, nature of fuel. So we cannot change the nature of the fuel. Instead, right? So if you able to adapt this SA engine fuel in CA engine, then we have to go for some modification. Some way or other way, we can at least, we can replace some quantity of diesel, right? So that is the aspect, idea. So first is, we can say we are going to discuss about alcohol fuels, methanol, ethanol, right? Using a CA engine and SA engine, right? So that's what I told you, like, you know, first you have to see the advantages and disadvantages, and now we have to look at the properties. So when you look at the properties of alcohols, from the property itself, you know, you can able to see what are the, or you can able to judge what are the modifications are needed, right? For example, if you go to the density. So density of gasoline is 820 kilogram per meter cube, and ethanol is 720, 790, and methanol is 790, right? So if density is lower, so what kind of modification is needed? So automatically, so we have to go for a bigger storage, right? There is a mandatory. See, for example, higher dense fuel, we need to have a less space to store more amount of fuel. But here, when you go for a lower density, for example, your gaseous fuel, gaseous fuels are very low density. So when you go for a low, very low density, the storage should be very, very high, right? So that is a problem, right? So when you see the properties, you can able to understand. Next is the calorific value. See that the calorific value of gasoline is about 42,000 kilojoules per kilogram. Ethanol is 26,000 and methanol is 19,000. It is almost, we can say, half of the gasoline. So when you go for half of the gasoline calorific value, so then you have to go for a double the petrol tank, right? So there is no other option. At the same time, so we have to inject more amount of fuel to maintain the same power output. So to inject more amount of fuel, so either you have to, if it is a ECU, then you have to reprogram the system to inject more quantity of fuel, or if it is a carburetor vehicle, you have to modify the carburetor, right? Or we can say jet size to supply more quantity of fuel, right? So this is a modification we have to go. So that's what I told you. Like when you look at this properties, you can able to see what are the modifications needed. From the density point of view, we can say we have to go for a bigger tank, and the calorific point of view, so we have to, if it is a fuel injection system, we have to modify the fuel injection quantity, either ECU, right? Or if it is a carburetor system, we have to go for a different size of this one. Like next is a latent heat of vaporization. So 400 kilojoules per kilogram for gasoline is about 900,000. It is about doubled. So when you go for a high latent heat of fuel in the engine, so there's a problem with the the converting this liquid fuel into vapor form. So in that case, we have to go for a heater, right? Either in the inlet manifold, especially in the during the starting problem, you will have a lot of problems. So automatically, if you go for a heating element, or we can say heating system in the inlet manifold, so that we can able to solve the problem. And the stoichiometric air fuel ratio, you see that 14:1, that is about for to burn. What is stoichiometric air fuel ratio? To burn 1 kilogram of fuel, we need 14 kilogram of air. But when you go for the ethanol and methanol, you see the 9:1 and 6.45:1. Again, so stoichiometric air fuel ratio is very, very low. So automatically, we have to supply more amount of fuel to maintain the power, right? All right, and again, we talked about, the corrosive nature of the alcohols. Like, always it easily react with the metals and plastic, or we can say rubber components. So when the fuel react with these components, automatically we have to go for a better materials, like when you use alcohol fuel in the light, right? Either it's a filter material, or we can say fuel feeding tubings, or any the fuel injection type. Either way, you have to modify the system completely. Otherwise, if shorter run, we don't have problem. But when you go for a longer run, you'll have a lot of problem. Right. So this is what, the modifications needed. Previously, I have not mentioned. Is that the CTA number? I have not mentioned. Actually, the octane number of the alcohol fuels are higher. Right, when you go for a higher octane fuel, so the compression ratio can be increased, right? Why? Because the higher compression ratio fuel normally actually lead to knocking. But as this fuel is having higher octane number, it has an anti-knock characteristics, so that we can able to use this fuel in a higher compression ratio engine, right? So actually, when you go for a higher compression ratio, the efficiency will increase, right? But due to knocking problem, the compression ratio is limited in SI engine. But as this fuel is having a higher octane fuel, so we can able to increase the compression ratio. That is one of the modification you can make if you want to go for a better efficiency. And next is a fuel jet size. Already told you the fuel jet size, as this calorific value of this fuel is very, very low, we have to, or we can say air fuel ratio is very, very low, we have to go for a bigger fuel tank. At the same time, we have to modify the fuel jet size. If it is a fuel injection system, we have to modify the program to inject more amount of fuel. And the spark timing has to be retarded, faster combustion speed of the alcohol. Actually, the flame speed of the alcohol is much better, are much higher than that of the gasoline. So once the combustion started, it ends very fast, right? So the spark timing should be retarded, right? Otherwise, the peak combustion will occur just before TDC. There's a possibility, you know, if you want to occur this peak combustion exactly at TDC portion, we have to retard it a bit so that more amount of heat can be converted into workout. Use of non-corrosive metal, already told you. So it is a corrosive nature, so we have to go for non-metallic, not rubber, you know, or we can some kind of alternate materials when you want to use. And double size of petrol pang, already discussed. And the next option is gasocol, right? So this is what already I have told in the, you know, first introduction itself. The government should take a lot of initiative to use this. Actually, government has opened a tender for the use of, for the consumption of methanol. Government is a lot of giving initiative and projects for the methanol based projects, or we can say ethanol also. But some way or other way, it is not clicking in India. But when you go to Europe, you can find all petrol station, you can find the two different kinds of fuel will be there. One is, we can say normal petrol, and we can say alcohol based, right? So what is gasocol? Gasocol is a combination of gasoline and alcohol. As I said, like, you know, before, some of the modifications before the slide I showed you, some of the modifications. So these are the modifications needed when you want to use neat alcohols. But when you blend this alcohol with some percentage, about 3 to 20%, there is no need of it. It is recommended, this one, like, you know, existing engine also you can use, right? So there is no need of any modifications required. As, like, you know, the existing engine, you can completely burn this fuel. So recommended is 3 to 20. That is called, we call gasocol. This is what, like, you know, government of India is planning in India. But in Europe, we have a 100% alcohol fueled engine, fueled vehicles are available, right? For that, actually, when you buy the vehicle, at that time itself, we have to see, like, we have to tell, like, you know, whether you are going to use this bio alcohol, alcohol or gasoline. So based on, you can choose the vehicle, right? The petrol station also, you can find two pumping places where you can fill this this one. But the rate is cheap compared to gasoline, right? But it's a subsidy rate. Because of that, they are giving a very cheap rate. It's about 50% lesser. And gasoline mixes only with water-free alcohols, which is more difficult to produce. See, that is one of the problem. So normally, gasoline will not, because the water-free alcohol production is little bit expensive. So there is a production. And no modification of the engine is required. That's what I told you, like, now, when you blend a little bit quantity of alcohol along with the gasoline, so there is no need of any modification. So gasocol has higher octane number and lower CV, because already you have blended with gasoline. So CV is little bit reduced compared to neat gasoline. And next is, you know, when you want to use this alcohol in CA engine, right? So the problem, you see that, when you want to use this alcohol CA engine, the CTA number is very, very important, right? CTA number is about 45 to 50, 55 in diesel. But when you go for ethanol, it's 8 and methanol is 3 to 5. In such kind of things, we cannot operate this ethanol or methanol in a 100% mode, right? So all other properties, you that this again, same for the SA engine fuel. So we have a calorific problem, and we have latent heat problem. See, the auto ignition, that's what, like, you know, mostly related with the CTA number. The CTA number higher and the octane auto ignition temperature will be lower. See that when a CTA number is lower, automatically octane auto ignition temperature is higher. So already you know that it's a compression ignition engine, so we cannot achieve that much temperature to start the ignition process. So we have to go for some alternate method, right? Either you have to go for a dual fuel or some other method to adapt alcohol fuels in CA engine. That's what, like, you know, next slide. This is again a DDMI. So, okay, see, these are the modifications. So when you want to use this,
Sir, you are on mute, sir. Edwin, sir.
Can you hear?
Yes, sir. Now you are audible. Yeah.
Ah, okay.
Sir, you can proceed, sir. Okay, sir. Now.
Okay. Yeah, I'm unable to view the. Okay, sorry. Sir, actually, when can I stop?
Almost, we are nearing the schedule, sir. We can take another 5 to 10 minutes, sir.
Okay. I will go a little first pass, sir. Okay, so this is one of the method, like, you know, ignition accelerators, you know, this is one of the method where you can use 100% alcohol. Already told you this DE and DME, so which has a higher cetane number. So when you add this cetane enhancer along with the gasoline fuel, or we can, sorry, the alcohol fuel, so that you can use 100% alcohols in CA engines. So this is one of the method to use 100% alcohol. And the second is alcohol fumigation. So you cannot use 100% alcohol. Maybe you can go for a dual fuel. So the fumigation is nothing but you have to convert the almost all the liquid fuel into vapor form, and you have to induct into the inlet manifold, right? So if you have a droplets, you should be recovered from this, or kind of any heating method or some method. You have to convert all the liquid fuel into gaseous form, then you have to inject. That is a alcohol fumigation. So 100% is not possible. Maybe we can go for some replacement. And the next is alcohol dual injection, right? So there are two injectors may be placed in the engine. So one will be diesel as a primary fuel to ignite, and the second may be a alcohol fuel for a better injection system. Developed a better injection system to inject fuel at a higher injection pressure. So that the ignition may be initiated by means of the diesel fuel, and the combustion occur mainly on the alcohols. So this is the second method, and surface ignition, right? So we see already, as I said, mentioned, the auto ignition temperature of the fuel is very, very higher. So also, you know, that latent heat of vaporization is very high. So it needs more temperature to convert liquid in vapor form. So to overcome this problem, if you're able to provide the glow plug, like, it's nothing but a heat plug, heating element, where, like, you know, the fuel droplets such a way that it pass through the glow plug, automatically the temperature of the fuel mixture will increase. So if you able to increase the temperature more than 400 degrees centigrade when the piston reaches the TDC position, so auto ignition may occur, right? Such a way that we can able to use 100% alcohol in CA engine, right? So either we have to increase the CT number, or we have to increase the temperature of the fuel, or we can say the mixture, right? So that way, that's what the previous is, ignition accelerators, where you are increasing the CT number. In this case, you are increasing the temperature of the mixture, so that we can able to go for a 100% mode. And here, this is a recent HCCA engine. So you know that HCCA is nothing but homogeneous charge. It is nothing but, like, you know, the CA engine is operating on a SA engine mode. Normally, we are injecting this fuel in directly inside the combustion chamber. Here, what we are doing, we are injecting the fuel in the inlet manifold, right? And we are making this into homogeneous charge when it going near to the TDC position. At that time, the temperature, the mixture should be favored to start the combustion, right? Or we can say ignition, right? So there's a little bit problem with this, like, an HCC engine, because the engine operate different condition, different load condition, different speed condition, or we can say different terrain condition, where the timing of injection is, timing of ignition is a problem, right? So spark ignition engine, spark timing can be modified, or we can adjust by means of ECU, and for CA engine, by means of adjusting the fuel injection timing, we can modify the fuel ignition process. But in HCC engine, the timing of ignition is the biggest problem, because, you know, we have to change the charge density, we have to change the charge temperature. With that, we can able to control the start of ignition. So this is the biggest challenge in HCC. Maybe you can also try some of the, you know, the method, like, you know, operating the HCC engine for different engine operating condition. So this HCC engine operates good in certain operating condition, not all, either it's a higher load condition, or we can say lower load condition, it creates a problem, Right. So if you're able to find some methodology to operate this HCC engine for all operating conditions, it would be the better research. Right. Next is use of vegetable oils in diesel engines. So vegetable oils, I think I would have studied a lot about vegetable oils. And so here the problem is, like, you know, we have a raw fuel. The first this until this point, we have a raw fuel. So raw fuel, you see that viscosity here, where exactly viscosity? Viscosity, right? 27, 46, 98, 49. And this is a problem. Like, you know, when you want to use this vegetable oil directly inside the engine, this is a problem, right? But when you convert into biodiesel, you see that when you convert biodiesel, the viscosity of coconut oil is about 3.3 and the kharaja oil is about 6.8. So drastically, it is reduced. So viscosities also play a major role while the mixture formation, right? Or we can say atomization, right? So we have to go for a better mixing process to mix this air fuel together. So and the heating oil, it is a little bit lower, but comparatively, you know, okay. But we have a little bit problem with heating oil. Maybe we can inject a little bit higher quantity of fuel in the inlet in the fuel injection system, so that we can able to compensate that. Flash point is advantage. You know, diesel is having 50 degree and the other fuels have more than 100 degree. So storage wise, we don't have a problem. But the CTA number, sometimes, you know, some fuel, for example, you see that coconut oil, the CTA is 56. The diesel is 47. It is very, very higher. It's good, actually. It's ignition quality is good. Use of vegetable oil. So when you want to use the neat vegetable oil, so these are the methods. One is, we can say directly you can go for a blending. So which will be useful for only for the short term application. And the second, we can say esterification. So we can go for a long term. If you have a proper optimized methodology to produce biodiesel from esterification, you can go for esterification 100% is possible. Thermal cracking, it is also one of the, but the energy needed to crack this fuel is the biggest problem, and it needs more energy. Next is the heating of fuel, right? When you heat, I already told you the viscosity is the biggest problem. When you heat this fuel automatically, because, you know, the heat and the temperature and the viscosity is having indirect proportion. When you increase the temperature, automatically viscosity will reduces, right? So with that, you can go for an additives and ignition improvers. Like, you know, for example, I already told you, like, you know, if you have any problem with the property, right? So if you have some kind of additives added so that you can compensate the property on par with the diesel property. So with that, we can able to achieve the efficiency, or we can say emission properties of diesel fuel. And microemulsification, right? Here the problem with the diesel engine is the already told you the oxygen present in the fuel. So when oxygen is present in the fuel, there is a possibility of more amount of NOx may be created in the biodiesel. So when the NOx is created, automatically there is a problem. So when you go for a small microemulsification process or against water emulsification process, we can able to reduce the NOx emissions. So dual fuel operation. So along with any SA engine fuel, either we can go for biodiesel with any combination, like alcohol combination, or we can say gaseous fuel combination, so that we can able to achieve the better efficiency. And next is adiabatic engine, right? So. And this is the dual fuel operation where the secondary fuel can be injected into the inlet manifold and main fuel will be injected in the inlet into the combustion chamber, so that we can able to go for a dual fuel operation. So because see, carburetor, when you go for automatically, there will be a lot of problem. When you have a timed injection of the inlet manifold, so the efficiency will be better, right? And next is the gaseous fuels. In SA engines, right? Gaseous fuel is one of the better options. That's why, you know, in Delhi, try to convert their vehicle into gas operator vehicles. Now it is not very very famous in South India, but anyway, so whether we are going to EV or not, but that's a mandatory. You have to go for a gaseous fuel. So already told you the structure itself. When you go for a gaseous fuel, we can able to reduce the emissions drastically, but we have still some problem with the safety and storage, right? So, the calorific value wise, we don't have any problem. It is a 50,000 kilojoules per meter cube with the natural gas. Hydrogen is also very, very high. And the flame speed, you see that flame speed is gasoline SL, I have not mentioned. Anyway, other fuels, LPG is 38 and the natural gas is 34. Hydrogen, you see that about 265, right, centimeter per second. Flame fluid is always lead to better combustion. It releases more amount of energy at very quicker time. So better efficiency will be achieved, right? And biogas and octane number. See that octane number, you see that 130, 130, 120, is more than 100. So we can say that we can go for a higher compression ratio engine, which can be used anti-knock, best anti-knock property. So gaseous fuel is a better option actually to go for, right? So any gaseous fuel in the IC engine, so either you can go for a single fuel, right? We don't have much modification, only we have to go for a fuel feeding system and the storage. These are the two modifications we have to make, because already mentioned it's a gaseous fuel, there's a possibility of backfire will occur. So to have a better safety, we have to have some flame arrestors in the fuel feeding system. Also, we have to adjust the fuel induction timing, or you know, carburetor. If it is carburetor, we have to adjust the carburetor. But nowadays, we are not using much carburetor. We are trying to go for a fuel injection system. And the CA engine, it is very difficult to use 100% the gaseous fuel in CA engine mode. It is very, very difficult, because already so it is self-finish temperature of the gaseous fuels are very, very high, right? So we have to go for dual fuel, right? So this is a hydrogen LPG induction of dual fuel, right? So the hydrogen and gaseous fuel, the problem is already told you, like, you know, see that when there is a backfire from the engine, automatically it can directly go to the tank. Already, you know, the tank, the problem is the high pressure, at high pressure, the fuel is stored. So when the fuel is stored at high pressure, when the flame is coming from the fuel end, automatically there's a possibility of explosion. So here we need to have some flame arrestor. Either here, if it is a hydrogen fuel, I'm placed with the flame trap, water trap, and the flame arrestor is more than enough to have a better safety. Finally, summary of my talk, there are many viable alternate sources of energy for IC engines. So alternate sources of energy may be expensive than fossil fuels now, then it will be cheaper for a longer run. So it mainly addresses the global warming and other pollutant emissions. Liquid fuels need not much modifications to use partially and sole fuel, but the gaseous fuel need a little modification to use in piston engines. So thank you. So if you have any questions, you can ask. So I have taken
participants any questions.
Thank you. Thank you. Sorry for that. So 15 minutes.
Yes, sir. No issues, sir. Okay. So we have planned, we have made the schedule like that only, sir. Or okay. We have made some half an hour gap between the sessions, sir.
Okay. So yes, no problem. Feel bored and listening the lecture for long.
Yeah. Anyway, we can accommodate that time extension. No issues.
Okay.
So, sir, any Dr. Palani Chami has raised a question. How octane number is more than 100? I think in one of your slide, I think. How octane number is more than 100?
Actually, it is a property of the fuel, like, you know, any alcohol or we can say gaseous fuel, which has a higher octane number. Because the composition of fuel is such a way that it is higher. Because you see, when you are going for a liquid fuel, they can modify this way in iso-octane, you can modify. But when you are going for a gaseous fuel, it is naturally higher.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. If there are no questions, we can end the session, sir.
Okay, sir.
So,
okay.
At this juncture, I thank Dr. Ed.
Yeah.
I am asking this question.
Yes.
Sir, only in the mixer we are expressing the percentage of isoactane. So the percentage cannot exceed 100. The octane number definition. The percentage of isoactane in the mixture of isoactane and N-captane, which gives same combustion characteristics of the original fuel, then if we express in terms of percentage, how it will exceed 100?
Actually, it's a good question, actually. Ankit, do you have any answer for this? Ankit.
I think he has left, sir. Whether he is there?
Yeah, actually, he is my one of my collaborator.
Oh, okay, okay, fine, fine. I think he has given that the commercial availability of B6, sir.
Okay, 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 okay.
Useful information.
Actually, sir, actually, you know, your point is very valid, actually. But in that aspect, I didn't think. But you know, it's like, you know, we see, because you know, I am working more on C engine, but my research is very very limited in SA engine. But maybe if you write to me, I will discuss with my professor and let you know. Thank you for the question, sir. Valid question.
Okay, okay. Thank you,
sir. Thank you. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Edwin Geo, sir, for your nice presentation and covering both liquid and gaseous fuel for the application of IC engine. The session was really informative, and hope the participant will get benefited from research perspective. Thank you, sir, once again for your nice presentation.
Thank you, the organizers, and thank you all the participants patiently listening my lecture. Thank you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So, dear participants, let us now have a break, and we can meet, join again by 11:45 for the next session. It will be a general session on universal human values. We'll join by 11:45. Before that, I could see some participants have raised questions in the chat box. One is about the test. Test will be conducted by 2:15 p.m. as per the schedule. We will post the link. It will be connected through Google form. The link will be posted in the WhatsApp group. Okay, that is one thing. And attendance, we have not uploaded yet because it has not been enabled for me. Okay, so I have to wait. I think after the FDP is over, I think it will be enabled. So I will be updating the attendance and the mark. I have to update. Okay, that is the second thing. And the third one thing is, from your end, ensure that you submit your feedback form. There is a separate feedback. Okay, for you have to fill that feedback from with your login credential of TEL. Okay, and MCQ pattern. The pattern of test will be MCQ. It will be simple only. Okay, so you can take part in that examination. It is compulsory. I hope you know already. We have sent the consent form. So 80% of the attendance is necessary. So we have tracked the attendance for every session. Okay, and you have to score at least 60% in the test also. Okay, so and kindly ensure that. Thank you. We will meet by 11:45.